Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading-Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Welcome to Your Berks Craftsmen. We're here at the 66th annual Kutztown Folk Festival.
I'm here with Vadim of Art for Us Studio. Vadim, tell us a little bit about some of your artwork here.
Okay. We do hand-blown figurines, and basically we're using the lamp work technique. It's done by torch. See, over there, we use the rods of glass, different colors. So on the flame, we melt them out. And when they are soft, we start to shape it with the simple instruments like this, tweezers, scissors, and etc. You know. And pretty much this art originated in Europe. And the Germany, Austria, Czech Republic, definitely Bohemia region, and the part of Poland, part of Ukraine are part of this culture. So also the some figurines that come from Russia as well. So and the definitely I forgot to mention Murano glass. So over there at one point, all five major glasses, like center of glass, were in one country, which is Austro-Hungarian Empire. So in the late 19th century. So after that, they all got apart, and now each country has its own school of glass.
It's very cool. How did you get started in it?
Basically, it runs in my family, so part of my family does that. And in 2001, I changed my career, so I decided to join them. So now I'm doing that for 14 years already.
Is this your first year at the Folk Festival?
Oh, yes. Yes, it is.
You having a good time?
Very good. I like it here, and they're very nice people, and very nice weather, organizers. Everything is cool.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. You can find Vadim here at the Folk Festival, and I'm sure he'll be back again next year.
All right. Thank you.
I'm here with Judy from Judy's Press Garden. And tell us a little bit about what you do, Judy.
Okay. I am a press flower artist, and what I do is I take flowers. My husband loves to cut and press them for me, and after they're pressed, I use them to make pictures and works of art.
That's cool. Do you have any that you could show us today?
Oh, sure. I have lots of things I can show you. My whole booth is full of them, but I have a few things that I've been working on today. If you have a few minutes, I can show you.
Definitely. Let's see them.
Here are two that I'm working on. And they're weather vanes, and I have a cow and a pig. They have to be glued onto paper yet, so I just finished them. And some of the things I use to make them, the pig is rose petals, the cow is a hibiscus flower.
So these are all real flowers?
Yes, they're all made with real flowers that I press.
Tell us a little bit about the process.
What I do is I start with the flowers. And if I have small flowers, I have to cut them and piece them together on clear contact paper. When they're on the clear contact paper, then I put a pattern on top of it and cut it out and then glue it together to make the piece.
That's really cool.
So one thing I have, if she can get in close enough to show it, I was fooling around this morning and I made Jake, Amos, and Sadie. So if you want to come in, I can show you Jake, Amos, and Sadie. And there they are.
Well, thank you very much, Judy.
Oh, you're quite welcome.
It's Judy from Judy's Press Garden.
Okay, I'm here with Ken Saul. He comes to the Kutztown Folk Festival for the last 10 years. Every year he has a project. This year he has a project. It's right behind us. Tell us about it, Ken.
The project this year, my son and I were thinking about it for the last 9 years. The project this year is a Chinese moon gate. And the it's all dry laid stone, so there's no mortar in it. And what I'm going to do from Monday to Thursday is go around the top of this wooden form with stone and put a keystone into it. And then I'm going to take the form down on Thursday towards the end of the day, and it's going to be a self-supporting 360-degree ring of stone. And it's a special architectural feature from garden entranceways in China for over 1,000 years. And it's very, very, a pronounced garden feature over there. The Japanese took it up and they build their own version of the moon gates. And there are many of them in Bermuda where couples, when they get married, they stand in the middle of the stone gate and get their pictures taken. So that's just a little bit about Chinese moon gates.
That's awesome, Ken. Now, what made you choose this? Have you ever done a project like this before?
I've never done one of these before, so we thought for the 10th year we'd do something that would be a bit of a challenge and be interesting for the public to see.
Okay, I'm here with Kathy Driver from New Jersey. Okay, and the car's all fixed, right?
No. That's all right.
Okay, we won't go there. Okay, we're going to start with Kathy. She has this is new this year, right? Okay, so I'm just going to take it away.
Okay, these are birdhouses that are set up for house wrens and for chickadees. But the thing that we did is we decided that we were just going to start to use a lot of recycled materials in our artwork. So here what we've done is we've taken the top of a swimming pool, an above ground swimming pool, and bent it so that it's not sharp on the edges, and then attached that to recycle wood that we found in the wood pile out back. My friend Bobby built them so that the lids will come off, so they are functioning birdhouses. You can actually use them, and according to the size of the hole, we've got this set up for chickadees and for house wrens. But with everything that's been going on this year with, you know, use and reuse and cut down on all of the garbage, we also decided that we wanted, and as you know from years past, I've been hand painting mailboxes for over 20 years. My mailboxes are all around the country and in Austria, England, and Japan. But these here, what we've decided to do this year is we took old license plates.
That's cool.
And we reinforced mailboxes to make the mailboxes stronger. The original thing that we heard from all of our customers was, how do we hold up to the snowplows? The mailboxes have not been holding up because of the weather. So we wanted to make them stronger. And I was out at the Minnesota State Fair, and all I heard was dents and scratches. So I said to my customer, I'm riding home on a 20-hour ride back to Madison, New Jersey, how do we make the mailboxes stronger? And we decided to start working with license plates. So what we do is they're all attached with rivets. We work with an aluminum mailbox so it won't rust. And it's just a fun, different from the work that you've seen me do in years past.
Because you do not paint those mailboxes. We know someone else does.
Right. Yeah, that would be the other side of the booth, the entire, and as I said,
there.
Been there everywhere. And another new product that we've had in the last couple of years is all of these hummingbird feeders. And the hummingbirds, it's just another dimension to your garden, is to invite all of the wildlife into your garden. And hummingbirds originally are attracted to the reds. But a lot of the commercial foods have red food dye in them, which is not good for the hummingbirds. They're little tiny bodies, and you're adding toxic chemicals. So I try to paint a lot of on red glass, or I'll paint red flowers on it to make it so that the hummingbirds are attracted. But the hummingbirds always want to have their hummingbird food fresh. So it's simply 1/4 cup sugar, 1 cup of water. I heat it on the stove to blend it, but you can store it in the refrigerator. Start out just using a little bit because they don't want to have any mold or it will ferment. So change it every 5 to 7 days.
That's not bad, though.
It's easy. It's an easy thing, and it's a nice way to have a whole nother creature in your garden.
And you have to look at the beautiful painting on there, you know. So the hummingbirds are attracted to the red glass, and the people are attracted to the beautiful painting.
And the hummingbirds. We love to have them in our garden.
Oh, yes, we do.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome so much. Have a great day at the festival.
Thank you. And I'm going the wrong way.
All right.
Say that again.
Have a great day at the festival.
Thank you. I'm here with Bill from Stone's Throw Pottery. And Bill is throwing a mug body here, so we're going to watch him do that. I'm going to stand in the line of fire here, right? And hopefully not, though, but nothing's going to fly off of here, right?
No. Well, at this point, this one's been throwing, and after it dries for a little bit longer, I'll be able to turn it upside down and trim the foot, and then I'll pull the handles and attach them. Yeah, usually we'll I'll throw them and then say 12 to 18 hours later, I can actually work on finishing the pots.
Okay, so then when at what point does it go into the kiln then?
Well, after the pot's been thrown and trimmed, it'll generally sit on the shelf for, say, 3 to 5 days before it's completely dry. At that point, it'll go into the kiln for the first firing. We call that the bisque firing, which for us is about 1900 degrees. That firing burns out all the organic material in the pot and also leaves it strong enough that when you pick it up, you won't casually break it. You can finish decorating it. It's still porous to water, so our glazes, which are all suspensions of things like clay and silica and different oxides to color it, are suspended in the water, and that can easily transfer onto the pot. And then after the pots have been glazed, we'll put them back in the kiln and we'll fire them to a little over 2200 degrees. That'll fully vitrify the pot so it's watertight and get a nice glassy melt on the glaze.
So technically speaking, if you add up all the time, it's about 2 weeks.
2 to 3 weeks is about as fast as we can push it through the studio.
Okay, so we're going to spin around here a little bit.
All right. It sounds kind of silly, but the clay balls actually get a little stiff as they sit. The water migrates out to the outside of the package, and when you kind of bat it around, the clay particles start sliding against each other because they're lubricated by water. And you can feel the change in it after you warm it up a little bit.
There's a lot of science involved in this craft.
More in the glazing than the... This throwing a pot is kind of like learning to play a musical instrument. It's mostly muscle memory. You need to kind of work through the same sort of series of exercises as you train your hands to do what you want without particularly thinking about it. Excuse me. I use a mixture of heavy slip and water as a lubricant when I'm throwing. I'm compressing.
It's magical as it appears.
Magical. I'm compressing the bottom of the pot right now. This both evens it out and helps prevent the bottom from cracking as it dries. Most any pot you make other than a bowl is going to start as a cylinder. You'll generally throw the pot to as tall as it's going to get before you begin shaping it. I keep recompressing the rim as I work with it, both to keep it from getting overly wet and to strengthen it. Helps keep it in alignment too. I'm adding a lot of slip to this. I need to keep my hands well lubricated. If they start dragging on the pot, that is the worst situation. It's, you know, the next thing you know, you'll torque the pot and you'll see a twist in it or something bad will happen.
I'm like becoming hypnotized watching it go round and round.
Yeah. Sandra says, as I'm sitting here, I'm working you, next thing you know, my head's going like that.
It is a fascinating craft, though. I mean, a lot of people just admire the beautiful work that you and Sandra do. I know that you're the thrower and she's the decorator.
Well, Sandra throws the pots, too. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, she taught me, so I suppose she gets credit for my work as well. But you're correct, is that we do kind of divvy up the work, and the taller pieces, as she started doing more and more intense decoration on the pots, I end up doing more of the throwing just because I've got more time available. So here we're going to shape this a little bit. I'll push it out. Let's pull this, collar it in. Now let's clean off the outside.
Like I said, magic in his hands, right? You know, totally fascinated by it.
Just a little bit more. I need the neck a little bit narrower proportionally on this piece. So as I squeeze that in, and then we come up here and just thin that a little bit and strengthen it. Coloring in almost always makes the lip a little bit uneven, but that's easy to compensate for. You always want to clean the mud and water out of the inside. If you leave that in there, it'll soak into the bottom of the pot and it'll almost certainly crack on you. Mm-hmm. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
Let's take this is a chamois. Same sort of leather you'd use to wax a car, but it's very tolerant of water and also is very smooth. So take a look at our shape. I think we can tweak that just a little bit more. It's always good to come back near the end of a piece and take a look at the profile, make sure you're happy with it. And we'll just extend that neck out just a little bit. And we have a small bottle. Last thing we'll want to do is cut the excess clay away from the foot. That both lets you see the shape a little bit better, and it'll help with the drying on the pot. Mm-hmm. And we'll wire it off.
And voila!
Another one.
That's awesome. Yeah. So you do start out, when you put that clay on there, you do know what you're going to do.
Generally. Most of the time, the results are better if I have an idea what I want to do. Though, and there are times when you're just experimenting and you're trying to create a new shape.
Sure.
You might start with a sketch or a picture of someone else's work. Or you might just start with an idea, and so you'll think about, well, what are the proportions I want on the piece? How big should the foot be? How tall am I aiming for? How big is the opening going to be? And then once you have those things defined, you can start thinking about what curve you want in between there. Is it going to be a broad-shouldered piece? Is it going to be a relatively slender one? What purpose is it going to be? Is it something that's going to contain flowers? Is it something that might contain food? Does it need to be more stable? So should it have a wider base so that it's not as easy to tip over, or can it tolerate a narrower base and look a little more elegant?
Thank you for letting us watch you create this one today, and thank you for letting us stop here. I know I interrupted your lunch, but you were gracious. Okay, get back to lunch, and thank you. Hi, I'm here with Jennifer from Lairware Crafts, okay? And Jennifer makes beautiful, beautiful floor cloths. Someone is going to say, what are floor cloths?
Okay, well, floor cloths are a really old craft. They started in England and France, and they were basically made from sails from a ship.
Okay.
In the old days, they had sailboats were the tractor trailers of the day.
Right, and right.
So when the sails would break due to a blowout or whatever, if they couldn't make a smaller sail, they started painting them and putting them on floors to save the floor, to look fancy. Like if they didn't have a lot of money, they tried to act like they had a beautiful floor. So
right. It was kind of like replacing rugs, right? I mean, carpet. They had,
right.
they had that.
They did have carpet makers at the time, Oriental carpets, all that. But you had to be very wealthy to have a rug of that sort. So they reduced drafts, all kinds of things, protected the floors, looked pretty, and so anyway, then...
And recycling. They recycled the sails.
So that was like even 15th century they were doing this. So fast forward to America.
Okay.
That's where I'm interested in history, colonial history. And so the early colonists imported them because they were so busy settling America. They didn't have time to worry about a floor cloth. Plus they, you know, just weren't doing it. And then they imported them, and three presidents have been known to have them. Jefferson, definitely, Washington, and one other early president. And the reason they know that is because they were documented in their inventories. For taxation purposes, they need to know what was valuable in the household. So these were considered very valuable to an early colonist. So... after they got their acts together, sign makers, I was just telling a little girl today, back then everybody had a craft. People were craftsmen. They all had a job.
Right, right.
And sign makers took up the art. Because they were very precise with their painting. And so they started making them, and it was all very good. Everybody was buying them and having them and making their own, some people did. And then along came 1860, a gentleman was in his workshop playing around trying to make glue, I think it was. And he was experimenting, and he took some sawdust and some linseed oil and a few other things. And it bubbled up and foamed out all over, out of the can and all over his work table. And it was a sticky, gooey mess, and he couldn't wipe it up. It was such a mess. So he went inside his house and he came back out hours later, and it had hardened, but it was pliable. It could move it, and then linoleum was invented.
There it was.
So that, of course, could be mass-produced more than the hand-painted floor cloth. So the floor cloth makers kind of went out of business.
There you go. But you came back into business.
Yes.
Okay.
So in the 60s... the American artist movement, you know, was trying to bring, everybody was interested in history once again, so.
1976.
Yeah, so they started making them. There's a few of us out there. It's not real well known yet, so. That's the story.
And you have one here, right?
Right.
This is the beginnings of it?
Right, I'm working on this, just a simple star pattern. I do almost any kind of thing from freehand work to simple patterns that are popular. Everybody likes stars. They're in the sky, you know. They're very, very historically, they're through all kinds of civilizations. The star pops up everywhere. When you start looking back through history of art, you see these designs, they just go around in circles, it seems. So anyway, people like stars, so I'm painting those today. They're pretty easy.
And the fabric?
This is a heavy canvas that I order special, heavy duty. The bigger the piece, the heavier the canvas will be. And by the time I'm done with one, I've approached it 20 times. There's about 20 coats of this, that, and the other thing, plus a sewn binding, and that's how it progresses. It takes time. It's about 2 weeks to finish a series of them. You don't do one at a time, at least I don't, because it's just not efficient.
No, because you do, there's a waiting process.
Yeah, everything has to cure and dry.
Right, right.
And sometimes you get, it's too much on your eyes, you have to go to another design, so.
Okay. Well, Jennifer, thank you for bringing us into the world of floor cloths, okay?
Yeah.
And your designs are beautiful.
Thank you.
Contemporary and colonial,
right.
Okay?
My brother said I have the shotgun effect. I have all kinds of things here, so.
Well, you try to please everyone, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you again, and we'll take a look. And this is your first year at the festival?
Yes.
Okay, and how's it been going?
Good. It's not hot yet, so I'm really happy.
Yes, you picked a great year to start. Okay, thanks, Jen.
Thank you very much.
I am here with Eric Fosnott, and he is here at the Kutztown Folk Festival for how many years, Eric?
I think this is my sixth year now.
Sixth year, okay. And he's not painting a sofa today, but but behind us are his wonderful, wonderful paintings of all his, some feathered friends, some piggy friends.
Yes, yes.
Tell us how it started.
I've been painting for about 15 years now, so I've done all of these. These are some of my originals here. From that, I started the tote business as well, Eric and Christopher, with my business partner Chris Klein. And these tote bags and the pillows behind you, we sell in about 800 stores across the country right now and keep very busy. But
they're all from, like, original paintings.
They're all from, these are all from photographs. Some of these are my farm animals. Some are friends and neighbors' animals, so we know everyone here. As well as the paintings, I know the animals. We also know all the animals on the pillows and totes.
Oh, how cute. So, name?
Well, I can't give away the flying pig.
Okay, name?
This one is Pfeiffer.
Pfeiffen.
This one is from Long Island Livestock. They do a llama farm, and she actually does shearing all over the country. So she sends us her animals, and
nice.
That's how we got to do the tote bags.
So who lives at your house, Eric?
The chickens live at my house.
Oh,
I have chickens and turkeys.
Oh, cool. And anyone we should recognize here?
Down here on the bottom is one of my hens and one of my roosters. I haven't done the turkeys yet. They're not as pretty.
Aww.
But we'll get there.
Beauty is in the eye of the beholder.
Yes, yes.
We've especially at Thanksgiving time.
Yes, absolutely.
That's we've a bad word.
A couple new babies at home, so we'll have new photos coming up.
Great. Eric, it's always fun to come into this booth.
Well, thank
okay.
you so much. I appreciate it.
I am here with Judy all the way from Arkansas. Okay. And she does these most beautiful, beautiful fine porcelain jewels. So she's going to tell us all about it.
Okay. Our jewelry is made from porcelain clay that we make ourselves. And we actually buy the clay raw. We buy it in a powdered form in 50-pound bags. And then we mix it up and divide it into batches and then add stains to them. So what we get is a lot of clay with different colors, and we start rolling them out or patting them out or just all sorts of different types of shapes, I guess you'd call it. So we eventually form a block or a loaf. But usually what it is, it's huge. It's like 25 pounds when we finally finish it. And then we pat it for days to get it down to this size or this size. And then we start cutting it because it's still the same clay that you use in, you know, kindergarten, although it is a porcelain, so it's much finer and smoother. And then we start cutting it and forming the jewelry, and we fire it in a high fire kiln at cone 6. And the last firing is actually a gold edge around the edge, which is a 24 karat gold luster that is formulated specifically for clay. And it is when it comes out of the bottle, it's sort of a brown color. But once you stick it in the kiln, it burns away all the all the emollients that make it a fluid, and then it turns into gold once it's in the kiln.
Okay, so you paint it on.
Paint it on, yeah. And then we put bindings on it and end up with different types of jewelry, everything from pins and earrings to necklaces and. Yeah, all sorts of fun stuff.
Okay, so do you start out with, well, of course you start out with some kind, or you have some kind of design because these are...
We do that on the computer,
oh,
yes.
Okay.
We do that. We have actually downloaded our colors onto the computer now. And we sit down the computer, and if anybody plays with Corel Draw or anything like that, we just sort of start playing with colors that we've got already programmed in there, and we know that these are colors we can duplicate in our shop. And then when we come up with something, we usually make a test log first, which is quite small, and then put it out here for the customers, and if they enjoy it, we make a big log afterwards, and the logs that are 25 pounds will last us about a year. So they're big, you know.
Right. Yeah. So you said it starts out thick and then you keep pressing it?
Yeah. It I wish I had a picture. It comes out in a big loaf, like a big bread loaf, and it's heavy because it's clay. And so it's a big, heavy, and then we start patting it. And we want to keep the design more or less looking like the original design. So we pat it gently so the design doesn't get all mushed together, if you know what, you know, how clay gets mushed together. And so we just start patting it. And eventually we get these really long loaves that are, you know, like this. And they're, you know, and we just cut the ends off and make the jewelry. Yeah.
Well, thank you for taking us on that tour. It's fascinating and very beautiful. I mean, you know, it's, and so you do earrings, necklaces.
We even do, here's a tie clip. We made, not tie clip, this is a money clip. We do tie clips, and we do cufflinks, and this is a money clip that's sitting there, and those are new for this year. But yeah, we'll do pretty much anything that we think we can get away with and that people want. Yeah, because we get special requests occasionally.
Sure.
And we'll say, well, we'll try it. Yeah. The only thing we tell people is be careful not to drop it in your sink or something, because they can break if they drop from a distance. Yeah.
But very nice.
This, close to 20 years now. So.
How many years have you been coming to Kutztown?
This is the 6th or 7th year.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah. It's this is a great festival. I just love it here.
Great. Okay. Well, you keep coming back. Okay.
Okay, I'll try.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm here with Ron, and it's Ron's Roses. I did ask Ron if his name was Rose, but no, it's Ron. So okay, okay. Daughter Rose. That's what you told me.
So I have an 18-year-old daughter, Rose.
Okay. And so you named your business after daughter Rose?
Well, I really named it because I started making copper roses. That was one of the first things I made, as you can see over there. So I call it Ron's Rose, and I thought it had a nice ring.
It does have a nice ring to it. Okay, Ron, so they're made out of copper.
Yes. Okay. They're made out of 28-gauge copper sheets, and I cut 5 circles out, each one a little bit smaller than the other one. I drill a 3/16-inch hole in the middle. I take a some copper.
We're going to look at this.
Copper rod, and I cut about a 17-inch piece off, and then I thread the top the top part with 3/16-inch die, and I drill 8 holes in the diameter of it. This one's aluminum. I make aluminum as well. Then I put a nut on the end. I just made these 2 this morning. I put a nut on the end, put the layers on here, and then I heat it over here. And once it's heated, that gives it the nice color. Then I put them together, put a nut inside to hold it, put the 5 layers there, and then I twist them, add the wire, make a copper butterfly and the copper leaves, and then I thread it all together with this copper wire.
Now, you said that you heat it, and that's how you get the different shading of this. All right. Okay, so do you have a temperature that you use to get the red, or is it just hit or miss? How do you do that?
It's pretty much hit or miss.
It is?
It's
like nature.
Yeah, I set the gauge here to about 3.5, and I have a tweezers, but if I don't get it off right in time, it'll go from the copper color to the yellow to the red, and then it'll get like a bluish and get very, very dull.
Oh, okay.
So I take it off, and as soon as I take it off with a tweezer, I put it in water to stop.
So that stops the process.
Stops the process, yes.
Oh, okay, so it is a lot of timing on that, right?
One of the circles is heated on the stove individually, so it takes a lot of time.
Very nice. So how did you get started in this?
I had taken a 4-hour class in Pottstown on making copper ornaments, and I really liked it and thought a copper rose, I've always liked flowers, and I thought a copper rose would be really cool, so I examined a rose and tried to duplicate it out of copper.
That's very interesting. Is this your first year at the festival, or you've been doing the festival before?
This is my first year here, and also just my second show that I've had.
Well, that's awesome. Oh, well, we welcome you to the Kutztown Folk Festival. We hope you'll enjoy the festival the whole week. First day was a little rainy, you know, but we have sunshine now, right? So you just want to come out to the festival, right?
Yes, come on out. We'd be happy to see you.
Okay. Thank you, Ron. We appreciate you inviting us in here. With Dave, all the way from Atlanta, okay? And he brought some characters with him. Or you can come here and he'll turn you into a character. Is that right, Dave?
That's pretty close. Or caricature, either way. But it's a character.
I was going to say, it's a character. You got to be a character to become a caricature.
There, you've got it. You say it better than I do.
Oh, I don't know. But what brought you up here? You're from the South, and you came all the way up here to the Kutztown Folk Festival right. For the very first time.
Yeah, I know a couple different people from down around in that area who come up here to do this show and recommend it, so I got in touch with them and thought I'd give it a shot, and there's quite a good crowd here.
So when a person sits down here, what goes through your thought? I mean, what is the process here on, you know, they look like the person, but what's the take on it?
With every face, I'm looking at something different. It's usually not one feature either that stands out. Some people have something that's so predominant that anyone would notice. But most people, it's a number of things working together, and you learn faces. So when you've drawn thousands and hundreds of thousands of people, you notice what's different. Mm-hmm. It's like anything else that you do that many times, you'd probably notice slight differences. So you notice what stands out about different faces.
Well, do people come up and say, oh, make me look like a superhero or,
Once in a while. More often you get, take 20 pounds off, don't draw my double chin, don't draw my wrinkles. Yeah, you get a lot more of that. Than anything. I've thought of doing it over the years, and I never get around to it. I think of putting up my caricature price and then my flattery price. I don't know if that would work. It might just be for my own amusement.
Yeah, well, I think I would try that. That sounds like fun.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe charge twice as much for flattery.
There you go. I think they did that back in the colonial days, you know, I mean, when they came in, you know, they didn't have photography, and so a painter came in to paint the portrait.
Those that could afford to pay.
Right. So, you know, yeah. So I think you could get away with it. I think it would be
perhaps
worth a try.
Yeah, but then you end up sacrificing likeness. I actually heard a thing, and I read a thing, and I don't even remember what it was, but was saying that caricature, not very exaggerated caricature, but just good caricature, that people recognize likeness more in that than they do in straight portrait.
I think you're right. Yeah.
Because it's those things that they don't even know they notice about the person that's brought out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And switching gears, Dave draws dogs.
Yes.
I also draw dogs. Yeah.
That's cool. Are they good sitters for you?
Well, that's why, hooray for cameras on our phones.
Oh, there you go.
Because I do them live, but a lot of times I just go ahead and snap photos because dogs don't quite understand posing.
Yeah, yeah. Mine certainly doesn't.
Yeah. If they have pictures on their phone, they can text it to me in shop and I'll draw it. Or sometimes if I'm not that busy, they'll sit here with the dog and I'll snap a picture and draw them.
Well, Dave, I'm so glad you left us interview you today. I'm glad you came up here from Atlanta, and I'm glad the weather's a little cooler for you, okay?
Oh, yeah. Today's very nice. I mean, it starts to feel a little like summer today, but it's very nice.
Okay.
Very nice.
Have a great festival, okay?
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, I'm here with Kathy Richardson. Bill, her husband's over there, and they both gang up here, and they're the Suffolk Shaker Shop, right? LLC. Okay, all the way from Suffolk, Virginia.
Right.
Okay. So, Kathy, you're going to tell me what you're doing here right now.
Okay. Well, this weekend, my husband and I, we make reproduction shaker oval boxes and carriers. And so we are demonstrating our craft, how we make them. And yesterday, I had a big copper pot up here filled with water that I heat. And you see those little bands over here? There's some bands there that we make. I buy lumber. My husband cuts the boards. I run them through a drum sander to get them thin enough. And then we put them in a trough of hot water and wrap them around forms that we have and use little copper tacks to secure the bands. What I'm doing right here today is I am milk painting, old-fashioned milk paint, which is basically It's a milk protein powder that you mix with water. It's old-fashioned milk paint. And
it's very dull.
It's very dull, and the boxes actually start out maple. All these boxes in the front, we bent, and they're maple. And then I just got through bending this, and if you feel it, you'll see it's kind of in the rough milk paint. So I'll take a little sandpaper and real fine and get it down, and then I'll put just some natural Danish oil on them like I did my set here, and because that gives it a little protection. But the shakers, we're not shakers, of course. People ask us that, so I have to tell them who the shakers were. And some people don't know, but they were a religious group of people who came over to the United States from England, and they settled basically up in, like, Maine, New Hampshire, New York.
Kentucky. They're in Kentucky.
And in Kentucky. They're no more shakers now because their religion stated that they didn't reproduce, even though, you know, we know that the Quakers did. But the Shakers were unlike the Quakers. So the men did their things, the women did theirs. They were very industrious.
Yes.
Made a lot of good things. The flat handle broom, the circular saw, the packaging of seeds, really big in herbal medicines and things like that. But they made these boxes and carriers to store things, and they would sell them to the outside world to raise money for their community. They would take orphans in, children, and raise them until they became of age, and then they could elect whether to stay within that community or go out in the world. So we just enjoy the simplicity of the design, the functionality, and it's an old craft that not a lot of people do.
Thank you. You know, and I like the paint, the very flatness of the milk paint. Now, I hear when you mix the milk paint, it only lasts for so many days, right? You know, you can't.
I mixed this today, so you can see it dries quick.
Quickly, yeah.
So if you needed to retain this, you could actually put it in the refrigerator and keep it for maybe a day.
That's what I was going
to
say,
then you can take it out and add more water to it to get it to the consistency.
Oh, okay.
Because it will dry.
Yeah.
Anyway, I thought that would be kind of neat to bring this here to show the folks.
Absolutely. Yes, yeah. Thank you so much. And you have a beautiful array of boxes back here and all sizes and everything.
And we have a lot of items that we make for quilters or sewers, too. Sewing boxes. Yep.
Yes.
And big in the quilt industry. And one of the reasons we wanted to frequent the Kutztown Festival was that we were told they had a big quilt barn.
Oh, they
and
do.
I haven't been there yet, but I'm going to go check it out.
You better get to that quilt barn, Kathy. Okay, it's a real treat.
Right.
Okay, well, it was so nice talking to you today. And Bill over there, he's just sitting over there, but I know he's a big help into all
worker,
these.
Let me tell you.
Okay, thanks for coming out.
Sure, thank you so much.
I am here with John Stevens from the John Stevens Gallery. This happens to be John, right? Okay,
me.
Okay. John, watercolors?
Watercolors.
Okay. And just tell us how you got started in this.
Well, it was about 25 years ago, and I had actually met another artist that was doing a similar thing and thought it would be a good way to earn a living. So I went home and said, you know, I'd like to try and do that. So I just started working at it. And,
okay, so you didn't have,
not
in school, you weren't the great drawer.
In high school, I was probably better than the halfway mark, but I was no prodigy. No one was talking about art school or anything like that. But I was probably better than most of the kids in my class, but not all. So.
But you just wanted to do it. So you.
I just thought it would be a great way to make a living. And I knew I had some creativity, but I didn't know how much.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so. And so your inspirations are, do you take photos and then?
Yeah, my inspiration is early American architecture, antiques, history. And when I find something that I think I'd like to paint, I usually will visit it, take a series of photographs, then come back and recompose it. Sometimes editing out telephone poles and Winnebagos and things like that. So.
Yeah, you find those every now and again. No pictures of any Winnebagos here. Okay. You said this is you've done the festival around 6 times. You weren't here last year, but you came back.
Yep.
Okay, where are you from?
I live in Lancaster.
Beautiful country, so that's where your inspiration all around you.
It's all around us. It, you know, if you got lost on the back roads in Pennsylvania in a 200-mile circle from where we're standing, you couldn't help but see great things to paint. It's everywhere. So.
Absolutely. I'm here with Dan, and he is from Bowmansville, Pennsylvania, just over the county border, and he calls his business the Scrolling It Out Woodworks,
right?
Okay, and that's what he's doing right now. He is doing a name. Is that correct?
Personalized icicle ornaments. They're all out of quarter-inch cherry material. And I do all kinds of different names. I have 1,008 different names here on display at the show. But if you have a more unusual or more unique name, I have about 2,500 additional names.
Oh, wow.
So about 3,500 total names here at the show. And from every show, I go home with a whole bunch that I have to make that I didn't have on hand.
Well, very good. And sometimes, well, if someone comes up with a different name, they can go change their name and you can just do it for them.
I can certainly do that. I've had people in my booth already that were trying to decide on what their baby's name should be, and they would take a look around the booth and like, oh, I like this name.
Oh, well, isn't that a nice...
It's kind of nice, yeah. It's kind of nice too. I get a lot of repeat customers that would buy from me 1 year, and then they'll come back the next year and say, "Oh, we had a new baby in the family, or we had somebody get married, and we need another name." It's kind of nice.
Yeah. Well, they become members of your family.
Exactly. That's exactly right. That's kind of what it feels
like.
Yeah.
I'm sure it does.
And we tend to see a lot of the same people year after year. And so it's good to see those folks again.
So do you do a lot of? You said this is your living, right?
This is my full-time job. I quit my full-time job, my real job.
Your real job.
2 years ago, and I've been doing scroll saw with shows ever since, mm-hmm. And love it. I haven't worked a day in 2 years. So, but we do shows all over the East Coast. We go down as far as we're headed to Myrtle Beach in a couple weeks for a show down there. But we do a lot locally too. We're going to do the Harrisburg Christmas and Gift Show. We do the Apple Harvest Fest over in Arnottsville. But a bunch of other sites. You can check out my website on scrollingoutwoodworks.com.
There you go.
But that has all my show lists and information about me. So.
Yeah. So you like coming to the Kutztown Festival?
Though? I do. I like the show. They put on a really nice show. There's lots of things for people to do. There's lots of good food. There's lots of things for kids to do. The nice thing about this show is just about everything is handmade. Mm-hmm. So you can usually see the people making whatever their product is.
Right.
Which is really nice as well. Yeah. And you get to meet the people and say,
I think it's really nice for the patrons that come through to meet the artist, you know, and then they take something home that you did and it's personal for them and personal for you too.
Absolutely,
okay.
Yes.
You don't lose any fingers doing this.
So far, I've got all 10. knock on wood back here. But yes, the scroll saw, believe it or not, is a relatively safe machine. It's really hard to hurt yourself too badly on a scroll saw. There's a lot of other woodworking equipment that it would be much easier to hurt yourself on very, very quickly.
Yeah, the blade's not too bad.
It's not too sharp, yeah.
And it's sharp, but not too big.
That's right. And it has little tiny teeth on it, so this one's not. But, yeah, it's a relatively safe machine. I've been scroll sawing since I was about 10 years old, and... I just love it. I just love it.
Okay. Well, thank you for sharing with us today, okay? And we'll see you back at the festival. Have good luck with the rest of the festival. Okay, I'm standing here with Chris, who is, what should I call you, a forger?
Well, I'm actually the head blacksmith of the National Museum of Industrial History, which is what you see behind me here right now.
Okay.
I've been in this profession for about 22 years. I've been doing this since I was 7. I'm about, I'd say about 50% of all the tools you see behind me are actually my personal collection.
Wow.
And I corresponded with the museum about 3 years ago, and I said, well, why don't we take this on the road? I've been doing demonstrations on the road anyway, and I said, well, this gives me an excuse to have bigger and better toys to play with, so.
Nice. Okay, so this is your first year, though, at Kutztown Festival.
It is. I'm going to give you a little bit of a tour of the non-working section. Unfortunately, our hit-miss is not working, but I'm standing right next to one of my beauties right here. This is a 1902 power hammer that was originally driven on a line shaft system, driven by a single steam engine that did a whole factory. And what I love about this baby right here is that when it works and operates, it has 1 ton of downward force. And I actually make roses off of this. I take a 1-inch bar stock, and you can see, this is the bar stock I start with right here. And you can see it's about 1 inch in diameter. And if I would do this on the anvil myself, I would be there for a very long time. And I'll take this and I'll make a 3/8-inch shank all the way over, and then I'll cut a crisscross in it and make a flowers. Fortunately, I don't have any examples because they all sold yesterday.
Oh, nice.
And my hit-miss engine ain't working today, so ain't gonna get that done today. But what we're gonna actually do is I teach classes at Totscap Art Institute. We teach a forging class there. It's a 6-week course. You learn how to blacksmith. And my intermediate students, their first project they learn how to do is leaves. And so I figure today I'm going to show you how I make a leaf from start to finish. It takes about 10 minutes.
Okay,
all right? So that's our first stop, right over here. Inch rod. This is 3/8 inch mild steel. That's a little bit different than back in the old days. Back in the old days, we used something called wrought iron. Unfortunately, the price of wrought iron right now is about $225 a foot because there's only one manufacturer in Sheffield, England. So we cheat a little bit and use steel instead.
Okay.
But what we're going to do is we're going to actually, the first process we're going to do is drawing out. We're going to actually make a point at the end of it. And then I'm going to shoulder it, I'll section off a chunk of it, and actually turn it into a leaf. And then you're going to actually get a chance to help me put the veins in, and you're going to actually hold the hot metal for me with these tongs, and I'll put the veins in too. So you never knew that I was going to put you to work today, but I am. I'm going to put you to work. What I have behind me here is a 1909 coal-fired forge. This was originally used in the railroad industry to heat rails up. They would put this on a cart and wheel it down wherever they needed to do it. And where they never needed to put a bend in a rail, they'd heat the rail up in this thing. You can imagine how hard that was to hand crank all day long. It's hooked up to a 1905 Champion hand forge blower. It's a geared blower, which means every one revolution of the handle does 20 revolutions of the fan blades. So it's a very easy to do. And what I'm looking for is I'm looking for this to turn a bright orange color. We call it pumpkin orange, and you're going to see that next. Forcing air into the fire to make it hotter. We're bringing the temperature up to about 900 degrees when it first starts to now reaching over 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit, which actually melts steel. And this is all done with coal. Takes a little
coal is king.
Oh, coal is definitely king. This is bituminous coal or soft coal mined in western Pennsylvania. It gives off that particular blacksmith smell, I call it. It's the sulfur in the coal. But once I get up to that temperature, man oh man, is it cook. So it takes a few moments to first get started, but we're almost ready now. I'm gonna go ahead and pull it. What I'm doing is straighten it. I noticed that there was a huge bend in it. I want it absolutely straight before I put the leaf on, otherwise it won't look right. So now I'm going to put it back in and give it a couple turns. So now you see I put the point on. Now I'm going to shoulder it. And I'm going to make it round. You can see how I made it nice and round, and now there's a chunk there. Now we're going to turn that chunk into an actual leaf. So now we're going to take another heat. Nice and hot. So now I'm going to make a leaf. There's one side. Now you can see I have what's called the blank done.
Yeah.
Now this is where you're going to help me here.
Oh, this is where I get
to
help.
I'm going to have you hold this really tight with me. There you go, just like that. Hold it nice and tight. Okay? You're going to feel a little pressure. Just like a dentist. I'm going to line my chisel up. Take a cut.
Oops.
That's okay. And I'm going to cut my V's in it. There we go. Now you have all your vines in it. Yeah, we're a team. You do a great job.
Thanks.
Now you have your V's in it. Now, you'll notice in nature that all leaves are not completely flat like this. We have to give it a natural shape. This is a really cool process. You're going to see that log catch on fire. So we're going to heat it up again.
Oh, yeah.
Now, while I still have a little bit of heat on here, I'm going to wire brush this a little bit, get all the particulates off. Now, this is a really neat project. We're going to show you a little magic here. This is a brass brush. It's made mm-hmm. purely out of brass. See how dark that material is? Mm-hmm. Now, watch.
Oh, yeah.
Just like that, we turn it into a gold leaf.
Yeah.
And then we put a little bit of wax on there. The wax soaks into it, and it'll bring out the natural color of the leaf. And that's how we make a leaf in the blacksmith shop.
That is so beautiful.
Well, thank you very much.
Oh my goodness, that is so beautiful.
Yep, and then what we do is we turn these into hooks. You can see some of the examples behind you
yeah.
on the table there. But this is how we make all the hand-forged stuff here. That's what I really like about this as an art. It really is.
Oh, truly.
So not only do I make things that are very particular and very useful, but I also make things that are art too. And in fact, one of our demonstrations we have out there in our field is our spit that we made and our tripod that we made. We're actually cooking dinner as we speak. So, and it's all handmade by us. And that's what the whole museum is for. When the museum is finished, we hope to have a full blacksmith shop run by steam and be able to bring the public in and be the first of its kind to allow the average Joe Schmo to come into a shop, learn this dying art. And that's what my preservation is. This is a dying art. And a lot of us forget that this is what America was built on. World War I, World War II, they were all hand-forged items. You know what I mean? Yeah, it was a bigger scale than I'm doing here, but it was all hand-forged. And a lot of people forget that, and that's a sad thing. In America today, there's only two organizations that actually count the blacksmiths. They are the ABNA, which stands for the Associate Blacksmiths of North America, and the PABA, which is the Pennsylvania Artists Blacksmiths Association. And registered through them, there's only about 45,000 smiths in the entire United States.
Tell us again, though, about where the facility is yep. and everything.
The facility will be housed in the original Bethlehem Steel Plant. Now, the Bethlehem Steel Plant was in process and in operation from 1865 all the way until 1992. It was the largest steel producer in Pennsylvania. We did a lot of the steel for San Francisco, skyscrapers, New York City, so on and so forth. And it was sad to see it go. The aim of the National Museum of Industrial History is not only to preserve the history of the steelmaking industry and all of its attributes like blacksmithing, but also to really preserve steam engines. A lot of the engines you see are scrapped because people don't know what to do with them. And we're given the opportunity to come, donate it to us, we will clean it up, we'll make it working order. What I really love about the prospect of this museum, it's not like most museums where you go and you see static displays and you're like, oh, that's really cool. Nope, you're going to smell it, hear it, and feel it as it goes on. One of the neatest things that we're going to have there is a 14-foot diameter flywheel from a steam engine that will be running all day long. So I'm looking forward to that. I'm very excited about this museum. Very excited.
I can tell.
Well, thank you very much.
You've given us a great demonstration.
Well, thank you very much for joining us here at the Nash Museum of Industrial History Smithy right here. We are the only mobile blacksmith shop that's insured to allow kids to come back, forge an S-hook, and take it home with you. How cool is that, that your kid gets to learn history and participate in it, too?
That is cool.
So come on by, bring the kids by. We'll have them in the blacksmith shop. They can forge something all by themselves and take it home with them, too.
Great. Okay, it's my pleasure.
It's my pleasure. Thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate it. And thank you, Kutztown Folk Festival.
And BCTV.
And BCTV. Thank you guys so much.
Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival, and by the Reading-Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.